Hi, we saw in the previous video that if a position versus time graph is a straight line, then we've got a constant slope, and that slope has physical meaning, because the slope, well, we can take rise and run, we can go dot, 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 make a little right triangle right there, and we can identify the rise as the change in x, and we can identify the run as the change in time, and we found that V average is delta X over delta T. In this case, though, I mean, it's not just V average, it's just V for this poor little penguin chugging along right here. But what might be interesting is if we have a graph that looks a little bit more interesting, if we look at a graph like this. Oh, let me talk about what this, the velocity of this thing is positive, right? This poor penguin here. So we'll get a graph down here, and we could, for the same experience, we could do a graph of velocity versus time. You should watch some calculus videos. I have a few, if you're interested. Videos that will help you understand the calculus of physics, because calculus was invented for Newton to do his physics. I guess Leibniz was around too. But look at this. The slope of this thing is always the same. We can do that by putting a marker on here and seeing that the marker always is tangent to the line. See, it's always tangent to the line and always has the same slope. So that means that the slope is constant and velocity is the slope. So I can make a little graph of the velocity as a function of time, and I find it to always be the same. And whatever that value is the calculated slope that we would get from analyzing any segment along here. You see how all of them would give the same slope. If I chose this point and this point, I'd make another little right triangle, but it's a similar triangle, right? It has all the same angles, same ratio of rise over run. Oh boy, that smacks of trigonometry, lovely. But what if we've got something more interesting happening? What if we've got something like this happening with our position as a function of time? I deliberately didn't make it symmetric. That was not a mistake right there. So let's say I want to know the velocity between, let's say, 1 second and 4 seconds. 1 second, 4 seconds. I guess I can put 2 and 3 in here as well. But in between 1 second and 4 seconds, I could do a little bit of rise and run. There's the run, there's the rise. And if I connect those guys, I could find the slope of that line right there. Now, you wouldn't say necessarily that that's the same as the velocity at this moment right here, 2.5 seconds. I might be interested in that exact velocity though, but the thing is, I'd have to zoom in a little bit further. Now I might take the velocity between 2 seconds and 3 seconds. So if I go between here and here, I'd find a line that's similar slope, but probably not exactly the same. But ultimately, I want to narrow in more and more and more and more. So what we're doing is called a limit. And I'm going to define the limit as t approaches 0 of delta x over delta t. As I zoom in smaller and smaller and smaller right here, I'm going to get the instantaneous velocity. I'm just going to call that v because I can. This is instantaneous, meaning that it's the velocity at a particular instant. So, watch the calculus videos, you'll see this make a lot more sense, but if I were to make a graph of velocity as a function of time for that guy, let's try that a little bit. I'm going to take this guy and analyze its velocity as a function of time. Here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking initially the velocity is large. Look at the slope here. It's very large velocity initially. And then the velocity gets smaller and smaller and smaller until it eventually hits 0. In fact, it hits 0 at right about 3 seconds. So I'll put a tick here at 3 seconds and say that the velocity has to have hit 0 somehow. It'd be like somehow hitting 0. And then, oh dang, look, the velocity is the slope, right? So the velocity is negative here, and then it becomes steady. So what I've got to do is I've got to kind of curve out here and say the velocity becomes steady, because here the slope seems to be constantly low, constantly negative. So this velocity graph of that guy is doing something funky like that. That was my deliberate not making it symmetric argument right there. So it's interesting though, since velocity changes sometimes, remember this graph here of velocity, we could actually interest ourselves in the slope of this graph. So to that end, I'll propose to you a new concept that by analogy, remember we had delta x over delta t was average velocity. By analogy to that, I'm just going to take the same dang thing and say delta v over delta t. That might be interesting, right? And what should we call it? Well, it'll be something average because it's exactly the same format. Turns out that that concept is called acceleration. And the acceleration talks about the rate of change, that means divided by t, the rate of change of velocity. So if we look at that, we'll be thinking about the slope of this graph as a function of time. So I need to put that below us again. And I'm going to look at this graph right here. I like to keep this format where I'm always looking below, and now I'm going to graph the acceleration of this weird thing as a function of time. And I see that the slope here, slope is acceleration. This is actually a really big deal that the slope is acceleration right here. The slope is acceleration, and the acceleration starts out negative, and then the slope gets bigger and bigger and bigger and eventually reaches zero. So I haven't left myself much room. I'm going to have to scoot up a tiny bit. See if you guys can still rock and see everything on the screen. Here's the plan. I'm starting negative and constant. And then it gets bigger and bigger here and eventually reaches zero. It looks like there is no slope in this region, and that corresponds here. And the slope is negative right there, and that corresponds to that time right there. See, it's kind of straight, and then something weird happens right here, and we get to zero. I'm just trying to give you an idea about acceleration. So let's make a little table of some stuff that we know. We know three things now. I guess we know a lot about time, right? But we'll just talk about the distance related things. We know position and displacement, that's all measured in meters. We know velocity, and that's measured in meters per second, because velocity is, well, we have delta x over delta t. Maybe we're taking a limit or not, but we're dividing by t. And then we get delta v over delta t, which means we're dividing by time again. So I'm going to say acceleration has units of meters per second squared. Oh, dang. Do you think we could keep going? This is very clearly a pattern of dividing by t. What if I say then delta acceleration divided by delta t? Well, that would have units of meters per second squared. I'm going to call that sucker jerk. This is a real scientific term. It's the feeling that you get, like a shifting of your balance when you're braking a car. Somebody else breaking a car, probably, because then you don't anticipate it, right? The car begins to brake and suddenly your balance is shifted. Or when a subway car starts or stops, think about that. Think about that feeling that you get. That is called jerk. Okay, so now I want to summarize what's happening if you've got, no, let's do it in another video. Bye-bye.